You're listening to the audio production of The Coming Revolution by Dr. Richard Lee, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Daniel Butler.
Introduction. Who could have anticipated, even a year or two ago, that the backlash against increasing government control we are seeing in Washington and in state capitals all around the country would be happening now? The truth is, traditional conservatives and people of faith have been speaking out about the direction of government and the need for accountability for years. There have been books and broadcasts of all kinds warning about the risk. I have produced a number of them myself, but it wasn't until there was a critical mass of concerned men and women willing to stand up and speak out that such a moment could actually happen. Led by their own deeply held convictions and the promptings of their faith, men and women with highly visible public platforms helped spread the word, and that vital spark has helped to set a whole range of events in motion. The Restoring Honor Rally on the Washington Mall on August 28, 2010, was a striking example of that emerging spirit. But it was just one event. There will be many others. So long as the need is there and the will of the people remains as strong as it is today. Surprisingly similar to those who birthed another revolution on these shores 236 years ago, ordinary citizens are the real voices of this anti-big government revolution. All they really want is to get back to the kind of government the founders gave us in the first place. There are no signs of violence at the moment, and that is because most Americans are still optimistic that their voices are being heard by our newly elected officials. They believe the results of the 2010 midterm elections will help to restore power to the citizenry. The new conservative majority in the U.S. House of Representatives is moving toward less government spending and reduced regulations for the moment. But if something should happen to derail that progress, or if enough people feel they are being disenfranchised by our political leaders, then anything could happen. Many of the identical social and religious provocations that spurred the American colonists to revolt in the 18th century are present again today, inspiring a new generation of patriots to seek what the founders called a new birth of freedom. To appreciate where we are and where all these things can lead, I believe we will need a better understanding of our history and of why the founding documents were written as they were, granting unprecedented freedoms to the people and establishing the rule of law. If we understand the environment of the revolutionary era as well as the political conditions we are facing today, we will have a much better idea of how things will likely play out in the future, and that will be an important part of this book. A new sense of urgency. Revolutions don't just happen. They happen because of widespread frustration and a history of disappointments, insults, and provocations of many kinds that eventually compel people to respond. Whether they happen in politics or some other area of society, revolutions are always volatile phenomena. They generally come only after years of agitation, but they are never about just one thing. They result from a long list of offenses, both perceived and real, that set off a natural chain reaction that quickly becomes irreversible. And in the right environment, the situation can be explosive. As Malcolm Gladwell pointed out in his 2000 bestseller, The Tipping Point, How Little Things Can Make a Big Difference, revolutionary change often comes suddenly and dramatically. When a large enough group of people reach a high enough level of frustration, they take action first by speaking out more and more forcefully. But if their concerns are ignored or rebuffed, and if there is no sign that things are getting better, there can be a sudden and momentous change of direction. It doesn't take much imagination to see that this is precisely what's going on in America today. I am convinced we are on the threshold of a revolution of some kind, I don't believe it will be a violent revolution. It doesn't need to be. We have many other alternatives, and no one is suggesting that direct action will be needed. Thanks to the success and endurance of the Tea Party movement, we're seeing reasonable and measured resistance to the expansion of big government in this country. And it is peaceful resistance. Thousands of ordinary Americans are joining forces to challenge the direction our leaders have been taking us. For the most part, these are all ordinary citizens, men and women from all walks of life, and people who have never been politically engaged in this way before. But through their combined efforts, they are speaking out with a new sense of urgency, determined to bring an end to what millions now perceive as arrogant and predatory behavior by Washington bureaucrats and other elected and unelected officials who wield too much power. There is no mistaking the emotion or the intensity of those who are speaking out. The conservative news media have been talking about it for years now. But for the hundreds of thousands of men and women who came to Washington at their own expense to participate in Glenn Beck's Restoring Honor rally in August 2010, as well as for the millions who watched those events on TV or on the Internet, that was a monumental occasion. As a participant myself, and as a representative of the newest generation of what the founders called the Black Robe Regiment, I can vouch for the powerful emotions we all felt. That event was a way of making our grievances known in a respectful and honorable way. We came because we were upset with Washington. But we also realize that the surge of individuals' involvement in social and political issues today is of revolutionary proportions because a dramatic restoration of our constitutional values needs to happen. Those who came on that beautiful August day were of one mind. They all wanted to make a difference. They had seen what the Obama administration's idea of hope and change was all about, and they'd had enough. Evidence of faith. The American people don't need to be reminded that this is not the first time a large-scale popular rebellion has taken place in this country. The first revolution was preceded and inspired, I believe, by the Great Awakening, a powerful and seminal event. As I have re-examined and written about conditions during the nation's founding era over the past several years, and especially since completing my Foundation House studies at Oxford University, focusing on the relationship between the American Revolution and the Great Awakening, I've come to believe that we are in the early stages of another awakening, perhaps of even greater magnitude. The Christian faith of the founding generation inspired their love of liberty and emboldened them to demand freedom from British rule, and the greatest expression of that love of liberty was visible in the Great Awakening from the 1730s to the 1750s. The sparks of the American Revolution were fanned into flame by pastors and teachers, the Black Robe Regiment, who taught the people the biblical basis of personal liberty and obedience to the call of conscience. Today, we're seeing a new wave of pastors and teachers who are speaking out about these issues, warning about the abuse of power by our public officials, and stressing the importance of restoring honor in all areas of life. What we are seeing is nothing less than a new American Revolution, not with muskets and cannonballs this time, but with ideas. It is a revolution of conscience, of morality, and of honor, dedicated to responsible social, moral, and political reforms. I confess, I don't care too much for the word change these days, but vast numbers of men and women are standing up and speaking out, demanding change from the socialistic direction our political, judicial, and intellectual leaders have been taking us, and back to the values of the founders. By any measure, this is a time of monumental change. Washington's idea of change has failed, and that is why so many people are reacting as they are. we are witnessing a rebirth of the American spirit and a recommitment to our cherished American ideals. And just as in that earlier revolution, this one involves an amazing outpouring of religious commitment as well. We see it in the tea parties taking place from coast to coast, and we see it in the explosion of conservative book sales, the tsunami of grassroots activism, and the sudden appearance of a new generation of political leaders who are motivated by their Christian faith and who are having a tremendous impact in the voting booths. Getting our priorities right. This book is a response to the growing demand for information, insight, and inspiration. In it, I will examine the connections between our Christian faith and responsible political action, focusing on the importance of personal liberty and showing how revolutions past, present, and future may be connected. In the final sections of the book, I will also take a brief look at the darker side of revolution, which emerged nearly a century ago in a formerly Christian nation, the Soviet Union, and which continues to threaten democratic institutions to this day. It is my hope that a renewed appraisal and understanding of our nation's core values will motivate many people to take positive action in their homes, communities, workplaces, and especially the voting booths. The information contained in this book may be taken in a prophetic or predictive context, based on lessons learned from social conditions today, as well as the events of the Great Awakening and the American Revolution. I conclude the book with a discussion of some of the ways every citizen can become involved now to help shape the future. I'm convinced that every one of the problems confronting this nation today can be solved through concerned citizen action. Lawlessness, economic insolvency, and government interference in people's lives can be stopped. Sound political action that arises from sound moral judgment and individual initiative can help turn the tide and restore order in all these areas. We have to make personal commitments to be involved for any of these things to happen, and most of all, we need to have our priorities right. One of the most important things we can do is to follow through as the founders did, not merely by changing our representatives in the state and national legislatures, but by holding all our leaders accountable for their actions and insisting that they serve as our representatives, not as irresponsible and unresponsive dictators. And not least, we need to make sure our own houses are in order, that we have a resilient faith and express our reverence for the one who is the true author of liberty. During the fall of 2011, we witnessed a very different expression of dissent. The so-called Occupy Wall Street demonstrations in the streets of New York and other American cities. While the protesters claimed to represent 99% of real America, researchers describe them as an unrepresentative segment of the electorate that believes in radical redistribution of wealth, civil disobedience, and in some instances, violence. Writing for the Wall Street Journal, former Clinton pollster Douglas Schoen said that more than half of the OWS crowds are serial protesters. Approximately 98% of those interviewed said they support civil disobedience, and 31% support the use of violence to achieve their goals. Some of those questioned by reporters could not explain coherently the issues they were protesting, and many admitted they were being paid by left-wing groups and labor unions. These are not the voices of hope and change, but of anarchy, dissipation, and despair. Groups such as OWS are likely to become more numerous in the days ahead as socialistic-minded elites become more and more fearful of the growing strength and number of outspoken conservatives who are beginning to rise up and be heard. The revolution that I see coming is a good and needful one, one of faith and virtue, of responsibility and positive action, and a radical return to the values and beliefs that made America great. as I have spoken about these ideas from coast to coast.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.